What's up with all these studies that show an improvement in heart attack and stroke rate, but really not much improvement on all-cause mortality? Oh, again, what's up with that? What good does it do if you get saved from a heart attack or stroke, but you die from something else? We're going to talk about that in this video. It's maybe not as bad as it might seem. But first, a couple of quick introductions. The first is myself. My name is Ford Brewer. I started off as an ER doc. Got very focused on helping people prevent the things that bring them into the ER. Went to Hopkins, got training in it, loved it, ended up running the program there. And I've spent the past, even after I left, spent the past 30 years or more helping docs, over 1,000 docs, and I don't know how many patients, prevent disease rather than waiting for a disease to happen and hoping for a cure. You may see some of the faces and names in the background here, and you realize that there's no cure for death. And the cure for a non-fatal heart attack or stroke is not so pretty either. So that's one point. Let me just bring up one other introductory point, and we'll get to the topic. The other introductory point is, if you haven't been to our forum, John Lorscheider runs it, you really should take a look. The article for today came up from the forum. Ben brought up a good point. Not really new research, but I thought I would post it anyway. I'm non-medical. I'm not a medical professional, not a doc, but I look at this issue from time to time. If a drug helps in something like heart attack and stroke, but it doesn't really change the all-cause mortality, sort of like, what good is it? And again, great article. And he posted the link. I didn't even have to look up the article for today because, again, Ben posted it for me. Thank you, Ben. Now, you know what? I've wondered that many times as well. I tend to, even though I go on and on and on and talk about it's not that simple, I do tend to try to bottom line my own perceptions for a medicine or for a preventive intervention. And it bugs me when I see so many studies showing a moderate or a good effect, but not so much for all-cause mortality. That's exactly what this article is about. It was published, in Circulation 2017. So again, May, just last, just what, a year and a half ago. But the information in here is, it doesn't matter if this were 10 years old. The information in here is logic, statistics. And one of the things where, you know, you've heard that old statement that liars use statistics, may not lie, but liars use statistics. I mean, that's one of those things where if you don't understand the basic statistics on what's going on, you can really get bamboozled, as my grandma used to say. So cardiovascular therapeutics should aim to reduce mortality, but it's not necessary to demonstrate a reduction in all-cause mortality when assessing them. And here's the key point. And if it's misguided to attempt to demonstrate an effect, in other words, most of these articles should not have tried in the beginning because it's too crude a measure of either benefit or harm. Results are dominated by causes of death unrelated to intervention. The signal-to-noise ratio is low. Most effective interventions in public health and preventive medicine that have together led to substantial improvements in life expectancy would never have been introduced had policymakers said, look, we want to see an impact in the death rate, the all-cause mortality. Now, here's an example. The misinterpretation of of data by the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force for screening of abdominal aortic aneurysm, what they would call it, AAA. One-time invitation for abdominal aortic aneurysm screening in men age 65 or older was associated with decreased aneurysm rupture and decreased aneurysm-related mortality rates, but had little or no effect on all-cause mortality rates. Well, it ignores the compelling evidence in favor of AAA screening. The hazard ratio was 0.6, and there was no evidence for an increase in death from other cause. So together, these findings are sufficient to make the cause for screening, and I do recommend screening, especially for people that have 9P21. That's an added risk factor for abdominal aneurysm. That's not in there, and I doubt the author even knows that. Even relying on a meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials with non-significant result for all-cause mortality to argue that an intervention is useless is scientifically wrong and unethical, because when you have clear disease-specific benefit and there's no evidence of harm, because, again, of what we'll talk about in the next paragraph, it's a statistics issue. From the perspective of trial design, of preventive intervention, the endpoint is neither sensitive nor specific. Suppose a particular cause is 5% of all deaths in the target population over the next 15 years. Consider an intervention that prevents 70% of deaths. Suppose 3% of the target population will die over the next 15 years. All-cause mortality, if it were to reach that endpoint, you'd at a 90% power to demonstrate this, you'd have to have over 1,095,000 individuals randomized to show that. When's the last time you saw a randomized clinical trial that had over 1 million, that had anywhere near 1 million participants? So that's the problem. To get an impact on all-cause mortality, you'd have to have too large of a study. Now, I will say this, and let me go over here. Heart attack is a much more common cause than even 5%. It's actually 1 in 3, as you see from our friends in quotation mark, at the American Heart Association. Now, even at 1 in 3, though, you still need to be careful interpreting all-cause mortality. And we'll get back to another example of this down here. The cholesterol treatment trialist collaboration of statins illustrates the insensitivity of all-cause prevention. They were able to identify a significant benefit from major vascular events, but not with all-cause mortality. Again, it makes you wonder how often and how many times we're going to wait to see an all-cause mortality before we initiate something. A screening item that's near and dear to my heart is CIMT. I'd be very, very interested to see the impact of CIMT, because CIMT, not only, although it does help people that know that they're at high risk, it really makes a difference for those of us who thought we were at low risk. In other words, a smaller section of the population. Again, as usual, if you've made it this far in this thing, thank you for your attention. And if you have more interest in getting into this level of detail, head over to the forum, take a look. Thank you very much.
If you hit the like button, and for sure if you subscribe or share, the algorithm reads that as a strong message that humans think this is interesting and important information. And the algorithm can share it more than any of us humans. speaking of sharing, one of the best ways of sharing is on social media. We've got active Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn activities going on right now. We've recently started up things in Pinterest and Twitter, so we'd love to see you there. Check us out. Finally, with over 500 videos, a lot of people are saying, I can't find this video or that video. Our new social media manager, Kim Hermosa, is starting to work on ways to help with that. So join the community. You can click on the links below, and you can get a little bit better access. Thank you again for your interest.